Hi everyone and welcome back. In this video we are going to talk about this particular topic, and it is talking about Node.js best practices. So from now onwards we will start writing Node.js code. I mean, we will not be learning how to write code, but we will build some microservices and then we will decide the communication strategies. Before going to that level, I want you to talk about some best practices before you write Node.js APIs or Node.js backend, right? So this is the link. You can actually go through it. It's open source and I'm using it for sharing. I will also provide the link of this. Okay, so what are three things which you should know before even starting your Node.js project? Okay, so I mean, Node.js code you can write using Express, Happy, Koa, Nest.js, Restify, Loopback, CSJS. There are many framework available in Node.js using which you can write API backend. Okay, I mean, they are tightly coupled with ORMs. They are providing all set of features where you just need to write APIs. All different modules are there, right? But when you are building your own microservice from the scratch, what all things which you should take care? Okay, so there is one part, okay, you are using Nest CLI and building your whole project using command line. Then that skeleton which you are getting for the basic APIs, that is already using some best practices, okay, because that you and that place you are using some framework. But when you are building a Node.js app from scratch, then you should take care of few things, and these are, you should learn it, because there may be a chances where you are writing APIs from scratch. Then what are the best practices, and you do it in your daily life when you are writing Node.js code. So we will just go through them. It may be a lengthy video. We'll just talk about one by one. So first of all, like, layer your components, keep your web layer within the boundaries. Okay, it's from the name it is clear, right? Wrap components utilities as npm package. So we are always getting these npm package. If you want to like do a request validation, you can get a Joey. If you want to get a proper status codes for your HTTP response, then there are different modules available. HTTP status is there. You wanted to do a logging, there is a Winston library is already there. But sometimes we built our custom logic as a util module. So it's better that we should publish that as a npm package, as a private package for the organization, and you get it like @organization_name/package_name. This is how you can maintain that in the private npm repository, and you can use it so that the same code base for your logging, for your interacting with your microservices, you might be writing a lot of reusable code like mail sender, a kind of a custom logger, and some kind of utility which is actually talking to your SQSQ, RabbitMQ, Kafka to send and receive messages, like common subscriber, common publisher. These kind of reusable modules you will be publishing, and you can publish them to the npm so that our other projects in your organization can also use it. Avoid putting a lot of things in simple Express file, because yes, Express framework gives you ability to create a server within just 2 or 3 lines of code. But it doesn't mean that you put a middleware, you put a routes, you put a start script of the server in a single file. You should always keep Express app and server initialization in a separate files. Okay, use environment aware, secure, and hierarchical count configs. I mean, we always need to maintain the environment for dev, stage, production, beta environment. So we should use a proper hierarchy or proper key value pairs for the environment variables, so that you don't end up committing those configurations or some private keys to the GitHub or GitLab, whatever the version control you are using. So you can use a .env, .env config and all. Error handling, because now we are not writing callbacks. So first of all, avoid writing callbacks. If there is some library is providing callback implementation only, try to convert that into a promise based implementation that will help you to deal with errors, right? Otherwise, somehow you will end up in the callback, nested callback situation, which is not good. In the async await, you can just wrap your code inside a try catch. That would be enough. In the catch, you just send a response to the client with the error. Okay, use only the built-in error objects. Okay, so like Nest.js is providing HTTP exceptions for bad request exception, internal server exceptions. you are already getting these internal server internal exception objects, so you don't need to create a new file node found exceptions and all these things. Handle errors centrally, not within the middlewares. In ExpressJS or any framework, we always have these loggers and middlewares or interceptors. So middlewares, don't overload middlewares for the error handling, because that is not what they are made for. They are made for the pre-validation checks, and if the validation checks are not satisfied, then you will be returned back to the request. I mean, you will not get the proper response which you are expecting. Okay, so do the central error handling. Document API error, either you are using GraphQL or REST based implementation, then there will always be some known errors, like MySQL connection is not there, you are sending a request and you are getting some weird MySQL key constraint error if you are not using some kind of ORM. So there can be some known errors which you may encounter, so document that. Exit the process gracefully. This is an important point. What it is saying is, sometimes when you are, your Node.js process is running, something bad happened, right? MySQL connection is not there, or the limit of MySQL connection exceeded, and there is something wrong with the connection pooling, and you are not able to get connections, and you start throwing the MySQL errors. In that particular case, restarting the server is the best way, right? Best thing to do. So you catch all these exceptions and gracefully shut down the process and restart it. Because if you are running it in the container or a pod, it will automatically get restarted. But if you are not handling that unhandled rejection properly, you will not be able to gracefully shut down the process. You have to release the resources before restarting it. So that is graceful shutdown. We should use a mature logger, like Winston is popular one, which provides a console-based logging, a file-based logging, or stream-based logging, where you can write to some other system. Okay. Test using your favorite framework. You can use end-to-end testing framework, or you can use Cypress. You can mock the HTTP backend and try to break the code by passing the invalid request, invalid API endpoint, or something like this. You can use APM products like Application Performance Metrics. There are different tools like New Relic, Key Metrics. They can actually observe your process instance, how much request you are getting, what all unhandled exceptions or error you are getting from your APIs. Catch unhandled promise rejections. So always take care of this. At the process level, you should always handle uncaught exceptions. Sometimes what happens is you are not even aware that you may throw this kind of exceptions which are not being handled by any try-catch block. So in case of that, you should handle it at the process level and gracefully shut down the process and restart the process. Okay, you should try to fail your request. Okay, so sometimes what happens is, like, you are passing a request, there may be a scenario where your request may fail if you are not putting a proper validation schema, right? So for that, you can actually use AJV for schema validation and Joy for request validation. Okay, these are some kind of a nasty bugs. When you have a nested payloads and something is getting wrong, then you can properly validate the request object before even processing it. Code style practice, use ESLint, TSLint. Now ESLint will inherit all the TypeScript stylings also, so TSLint will be there. And you can also have Prettier RC, and Prettier RC is nothing but a formatter tool. Okay, and on top of that, you should always use ESLint. TSLint properties will also be there in the ESLint in future, so use ESLint plus Prettier in your code. These are the curly braces, I mean code formatting and all, separate your statements. These are just nothing but ESLint or TSLint level rules, so you should always include as many possible TSLint or ESLint rules in your TSLint config or ESLint config. Okay, these are just code level configurations which you should take care. Use async comment, avoid callbacks. Now if you are writing a code, then you can stop talking about callbacks. There is async await, which is clean and concise. Okay, there may be a use case where you have to write promise chaining, you can do that, but try to avoid using callback as much as possible. Use arrow function, so you will not end up having a situation where you are not able to access this context, because arrow function is providing a lexical scope binding. For testing and all, there are many other best practices I will say, so you can actually go through them. I will not go to one by one. Going to production practice, so you can have a proper monitoring tools like APM, application performance monitoring. You can have a smart logging like Winston or any kind of a proper logger. You can provide a log levels, info, debug, HTTP log levels for in your configuration, so that on dev, debug and info, there can be info as a log level. In production, error can be a log level, right? We don't want to log everything in production. You should use the proper security modules like Helmet is a module which you should use with the Express middleware to add on to the security on your APIs. You should use these SSL enabled APIs. You should do the proper audit of your NPM packages, NPM audit, and check the log dependencies and all. If you are using a Docker with the Node.js, then read about best practices to write Docker file for Node.js. Okay, so that you can have a lightweight container only running the required things. Utilize all CPU cores. This is important. What happens is like your machine is a 4 cores and you are running only a single process. Okay, you are running only one single instance of Node.js and you have 4 cores in that system, right? So in that case, 3 cores will not be used, only 25% of that CPU is getting consumed, right? In that case, you can actually create a 3 different instances of Node.js, so proper utilization of resources can happen because one instance will occupy only 1 core of the CPU. Maintenance endpoint, discover the downtime, use APM products, make your code production ready, all these other best practices which you can use, okay? Set your environment variables like node environment production. Okay, rest all you can go through this. This is very important before you write your microservices.